is Gert for Gert for the Americans and Thunder for the louder even. I'm Thunder for the IRC people that I talk to. I'm a little introduction. I'm from the Netherlands, but I live in Greece at the moment. Since I got there, crisis started basically. I've been involved with interchains since the late 20th century. It's actually called minivent in those days. Eventually changed to interchains, interchange 5. After that, I changed to Ruby because my job went there, so I kind of lost the work on interchains, but I kept in touch with Stefan and with Jura, and found out that there was some conference where a lot of interchange people, Josh, Peter, Sam, and these guys were going to be. So I said, well, let me go to Vienna, why not? And then Jura said, do you want to give a talk? And to Jura, you never say no. So I end up in front here. I haven't done any talks for the past 10 years because I live in my house, so I don't see many people. So it's something totally new. So I needed to come up with a topic to talk about. I didn't know anything about Dancer, so I needed to find something that actually fitted a bit the program. So I came up with social logins and e-commerce. This comes from the point that I actually did something myself, which is put in here, and will come up in the further talk. Okay, so social logins. Well, the what? Thomas actually started already earlier this morning, so this will be a bit of a repetition, which is the mother of all learning. It allows users to access websites using their existing social account IDs. You know, there are quite a few. I know if you want to just see, you recognize one or maybe even all of them. Facebook, Google, LinkedIn. So there are quite a few. Here's Stack Overflow for the technical people. They actually have their own. And when you try to open with them, you can still use your Google account. So it's sometimes very confusing who offers what. So there are many options, but basically if you talk about this, you basically talk about Facebook, because the other ones are pretty much irrelevant if you look at the size of how many are being used. So how does it work? We have a customer, an e-commerce website, which I'm basically talking about, more e-commerce, not other social websites. And you have the providers. We get a request for the login. The website sends an authorization request. The login provider gives some authorization pages back, where you can go on. You provide your social ID credentials, usually your email address and the password. There is a redirect with the result going back to the e-commerce website. They send an access token back. A request, an access token request back. Then you get an access token and everything works out fine. And display a result to the customer. And here's the maybe. And there's the step that the e-commerce website is usually going to ask for some more information, not just the access token, but some personal data. Here you see the sponsor, where you have the booking.com website. You have a sign-in, you get the sign-in form, you can connect with Facebook, or you can just access your account. And I basically did it myself. I'm not very into social sites, so I'm a bit more of the private side, but I thought I need to try it, so I tried myself. And I signed up, you see in Dutch, even though the website was in English, I got Dutch to work with my data. And it tells you what data is being provided to booking. And you can actually make a change because you can say, I don't want to give this email address that you have on your Facebook profile. You can give another one, but you can make it empty. Which is interesting. When you make it empty, Booking will ask for an email address because they need it. So you can even question yourself how fast it goes. So this is how it works. And of course, everybody knew that. So. And what happens is that when you're in your Facebook account, you check your app settings, it will add you a little icon that you are connected with that app. So what are the advantages for using a social login? I split it up to the customers, e-commerce sites, and the providers. It's these three are basically the ones involved process of using a social model. So for the customer, they say it alleviates password fatigue. People are bored to create 15, 20 accounts every time they go to an e-commerce site. Why should I every time swap with a new password mainly? Because you use your email address. Keep that in mind. And there was a study done by a company called Social Labs, which said that 92% of all people that they interviewed sometimes left the website because they had forgotten their password and they didn't bother to actually continue on the website. I think in e-commerce it's probably less because if you find the pair of shoes for the best price in the shop that you like, I think that it will be less obvious, but for basic social booking, it's probably that number. It offers convenience. Data is provided already to the website. It depends a bit on the scope that is allowed by providers such as Facebook, how much information is being provided to the new to the e-commerce website. For example, your address details would be passed on, which would make it easier for you to buy your shoes because the checkout it will directly put your address details in, so you're done faster. They hope for better deals because they know you, you use this functionality, maybe you feel a bit more connected to each other, so people think maybe I get a better deal if I use my social login. And brand familiarity, you come to a website, you see that you can log on with your details there, it feels maybe a bit more trustworthy. For e-commerce website, expected customer retention, because it's easier to log on, you can communicate easier with your customers using the details, you expect that you can keep your customer closer by, which will result in increased sales to these customers, and you can better target your customers. You know their age and whatever other information they have wanted to provide you through this social login, so can better target specific customer. It gives you some more brand exposure on Facebook. People might easier talk about you, so your company name is more in use and shared by your friends. And to set it up, it could be even plug and play, but if you pay, because it's not cheap. There are services who offer to set it up for you, companies like Young Brain and Gigya, but when you look closer to what they offer, they start with a very basic, cheap or free solution, but if you really want statistics and clear data, it goes to, I think, 5,000 euros per year to offer it through them. But of course, you can do it yourself if you're technically that. And for the provider, increased brand visibility. When you're Facebook and every website in the world, there's the button with your name on it. I mean, nope, everybody would want it probably. And data is money. I think that's probably the biggest for the known providers, that they just also get information from you when you log on with your account to this to an e-commerce website. Get to the negative points of having this for the customer? Privacy concerns. We know there's always a lot of discussion in how private is Facebook, how private is Google with your data, and how does it work? Is the issue that I sign up, how do they deal with my data? For some people, it might give a negative feeling instead of a positive feeling to see you can log on with your Facebook profile data. Security concerns. If you get your Facebook account hacked, then somebody can go to your app page and they can see all the apps that you have connected yourself to. So somebody can go there and use your logon to get into your system. It's not good, but it can happen. It can get confusing if you have three or four different social logons on one website. What did I sign up with? Which one did I use? If you decide, for example, that you don't want anymore to be connected to Booking, you go to Facebook to remove the app, but when you go to Booking, it's still there. Or if you go to Booking and you remove the app, and Facebook is still there, because there is no direct connection that if you remove from one to the other. So actually, if you want to leave, it's a bit awkward to be able to know if you actually broke the connection. Usefulness. For example, the very nice feature for e-commerce site is that your address data is added to the website. But if you take an example, for example, booking.com, they actually don't get your address data from Facebook, even if you put it in, because that's not part of the scope that is allowed. If you really want also your address data, then Booking as the company have its app checked by Facebook, and then they will release this data because they don't give all the data out directly. So that's sometimes making for an e-commerce site maybe less useful, because if you have a certain expectation, you don't get what you expect. And yeah, I wanted the social account postage. You created on several different websites your with Facebook connected, and then yeah, you get divorced and you really want to have that Facebook account because all these people are bothering you, then you get stuck because you are connected on 7-8 different websites with your Facebook details. So in the beginning it's great, but at some point it might not be the greatest. For e-commerce sites, legal implications. This is probably not really for the back, but this is a part of Facebook's policy. And things you should know is we can analyze your app website content and data for any purpose, including commercial. We can monitor or collect data related to your use of the SDKs. You give us the right to enable your app to work with Facebook, the right to incorporate information you provide into other parts of Facebook, and the right to attribute the source of information using your name or logos. It's a bit vague. We can audit your app to ensure it's safe and doesn't violate our terms. If requested, you must provide proof that your app complies. Again, it stays vague. They can audit your app. And basically, your app is an e-commerce website in this case. And we can create apps or products that offer features and services similar to your app. So if you take it theoretically, they can come to your company, they can check out what you're doing, and they can build something similar. They're probably not going to do it, but they say they could. And they guarantee that the platform will not always be free, but they don't guarantee that it's always free. If you go to Facebook and on Facebook, it says Facebook free and it will always be. But it doesn't count for the use of their connection. Maybe. So consider that they start to charge a quarter of a cent per API call, and you have half of your database using Facebook Connect, all of your customers. So what do you do in that case? Are you going to tell them, or are you just going to pay the basic amount? And then Zurich is not anymore free. And another one in the rights and responsibilities is the same, that makes the entire agreement between Facebook and supersedes prior agreements. So all your privacy policies and all your things that you have with your customer, the moment they start to use Facebook Connect, it changes. It's not anymore exactly the same. Which could be a problem if in your privacy policy you say something very strictly private. You will have to mention that once you use the Facebook stuff, it's not anymore, because they can't guarantee it. There are implementation hurdles, obviously. This is from Login Radius, which is a business who also installs it. So, grain of salt, because it comes from their marketing. But if you really want to offer 30 different kinds of social logins to your website, which you probably won't, it can start taking a lot of time to keep it up to date, keep it working. Usefulness. For the e-commerce websites, if that address data is not coming, what is the real use of it? What are you sharing actually if you start using Facebook Connect, stuff like that? Here, if you are logged out or under the Facebook account and visit the website with a like button or any other social plugin, your browser sends us a more limited set of featured info. So basically, if you put anything on Facebook on your website, whoever comes to your website is being tracked. Don't know, some people have problems with that, some others don't, but they actually are tracking everything if you cooperate with them. And if there's a provider problem, it's your problem. Because this happened by chance when I was building this presentation and I was looking at things, and I was actually using the booking website. That evening that Facebook was down for 2 hours, I was actually testing it. So it never happens, but it actually happened to me. It was like, nothing great, but it was 2 hours. But this is one, and it's also a story of a person from Canada. I think it was for Black Friday, I think it's called in Canada, that people want to buy a lot of stuff, and then Facebook had done something, some algorithm, and it had blocked many people from Canada out of their accounts for some reason. So these people couldn't go to their preferred web shop because they had signed up with their Facebook account. So if they want to buy something, they needed to create real accounts, which was rather annoying. And brand association. There is a well-known story, I don't know if you know it, for MailChimp. They had a Facebook button on their site to connect, but the boss told to remove it because he didn't want to show another icon or another product on its website. And you can also sometimes question yourself, do I want to be associated with Facebook, which has a certain image, especially when you're in e-commerce. And this is also the graph that if you look at ages, so it's 18 to 25 years, how they use social login. You see it goes down. So if you are in the category with an e-commerce website of people that are over 35, you're probably not doing yourself a favor if you add a social login. For the provider, the ones, well, I couldn't really come up with any big ones that stood out. So user statistics, I thought, well, let me have a look at how it's being used. So there was a study done by Social Labs in 2012, and they found that 6% of the top 500 US retailers were actually using a social login. And they said they were surprised it was little. Then I looked at today, around this time, so I found that there were like about this many websites in the world. There's some internet stats website they found. And in America, there was like, so this is statistic for the US, but there's so 170,000 online stores in the US. 8.7 million are using Facebook Connect, which is 450,000 websites in the US. 6% of them were in the shopping category. So about 27,000 online stores in the US at this moment are using a social login, and we can basically say to use Facebook because the others are very little. So if we take that, we come to about 22.5%. So in the past three and a half years, there has been a growth of the use of the social login. And then I thought, okay, I'll also do my own research. So I went through about 800 to 900 websites, checked them one by one if there actually was a social login. And I took the top 100 shops in the US, and you see that 21%, something like that, I came out, which is actually very close to what I came out with just the calculations, so it's pretty accurate. In Germany you see that it's less, and I think that has a lot to do with the German privacy rules, that in Germany people are still much more reluctant to use social login. And I also looked at France and Switzerland, Austria and Netherlands. I guess the less privacy concerns, the more social links are used. And you see here, other and Google is low. And so maybe it's Facebook that you use. Then I checked Interchange. I went to all the sites that are in the Hall of Fame of the Interchange website, like 380. And I found that there was actually one that used the social login, and it was actually Facebook. But I don't think that's very important. So the rule on Facebook. So I also picked Magento, which is more being used, and there you see that no social login is a lot less, and here you go to 25%. And I must say that I used two sources. And the second source I used were newer websites, and there it was actually about a 50% social login and not. So newer websites are more bound to use it. And older websites, as far as I could see, it's maybe the hurdle of implementation because you have to change your website to add it. So you see it's growing. And well, we came to Dancer, so we need to talk about Dancer. So Dancer has plugins. You have Dancer plugin both, and there is a plugin for Facebook, a plugin for Google, a plugin for Twitter, and a plugin for Wingo, which I wrote myself as a test case to actually come here because I needed to show some experience with Dancer, else I didn't dare to come here. And there is also another plugin which you can find on GitHub, but part of that is proprietary, so you can use it all. That has also connections to quite a few social logins. And there are two how-tos I found about it, which was from 2011 about Facebook Graph, how you to implement it. It's basically very easy. And there is one for the Twitter. One was written by Alexia in 2010, which was basically my big example to build my own, and it was very easy. So that's what I did. I actually created the Dancer demo shop, and it has a login with Wingo button. If you press any other link, you first have to log on. And then you click on the login link, you get to this screen, where it's basically what Thomas already showed. You get a screen where you enter your username, your password, and you sign in. Then it tells you you want to authorize, so you authorize, and this gives you your email, first name, last name, gender, address, date, and phone. you authorize, maybe it knows who I am, and it actually has my address details available for the show. And then Stefan told me, why did you do it in Dancer? Because we have Dancer too. Okay. So that was not very nice. But I thought, okay, let's try it. So there's actually a plugin called Auth OAuth. And there is the option to put providers, and there is Facebook, Google, Twitter. And I created my own as a test as well. And the big question is, should this actually be integrated to Auth extensible? So, Andrew.
What's the last question?
The answer is, we could look at it. But you probably want to talk to the guy who wrote the others. So, familiar screen, but it has a 2. And you cannot get in there either. So you first have to sign in. And it actually has a 2. So you don't sign up with Dancer, but Dancer 2. You authorize, hey, it's me again. And again, it has my settings. So now I'm here. And I'm using Interchange. So I need to talk about Interchange 6 a little bit as well, I thought. And what does Interchange 6 have with social logins? Well, actually nothing, because Interchange 6 demo store doesn't really work. Actually, that button is not really there. So I just fake this, and I fake my own next bit. But for example, you can have this. You can log in with your Facebook, which is not private, or you can log in with your Google, which is very private, in case you want to. You get a screen again. There it asks for a demo show. And it asks if you want to access with this data. You authorize. And there you go. Your customer information is filled out. And when you submit it, you get into your Wingo account. Actually, your purchase is all. So you can get a view of all your purchases. And that was my story. Does anybody have any questions or any comments? Thank you very much.